in painting in general, it's the precise that I like. I've always veered towards a sort of a technical precision in painting. So it's John Everett Millais I prefer most of all. So I've really never looked at Turner. I've never been interested in that kind of looser style. Simply I suppose the kind of painting I do is rather tight. Therefore, that's the kind of painting I've tended to look at. But a little picture like this is so beautiful. I mean, it's so simple and atmospheric that it's a magnificent little picture.
My pictures I give and bequeath unto the trustees of the National Gallery, provided only that they be kept together and preserved in a building to be used expressly and solely for that purpose, to be known as Turner's Gallery, whose object will be to keep my pictures as a collection of my work and to be seen by the public gratuitously.
On the face of it, it's taken 136 years for this to happen, which seems rather a long time, even by English standards. Could you tell us why it's taken so long?
Well, the money in his estate was never intended to go to the nation. It was divided among various charities, particularly the establishment of almshouses for indigent male legitimate English painters, and that was Turner's greatest aim, really. But he also wanted to see his work housed with the great masters of the past in the National Gallery. And by the terms of his last codicil, the final form of his will, the 100 finished pictures from his studio were to go to the National Gallery. But since his family and other people contested the terms of the will, they thought they should get the money. In the end, the almshouses were never built, the money went to the relations, and not just the 100 finished pictures, but everything in his studio that he had painted or drawn went to the nation. The National Gallery was understandably slow to cope with this colossal administrative problem, these hundreds of pictures and thousands of drawings. But all through the 19th century, they tried hard to show what they could. And in 1910, when the National Gallery's British collection had moved here to Millbank, Sir Joseph Duveen built some stunning galleries, which are still here, and where Turner's been shown ever since. Very satisfactory, I would say.
What value would you put on this collection in the Clare Gallery today, with 300 oils, 20,000?
Well, I think that's, there's only one way you could do that, and that's by selling them, and that is not feasible, but I mean, a picture by Turner has fetched £7 million.
Multiply that by 300, that's over 2 billion, isn't it?
Yes, but I mean, also a picture a year after that, a small, perfectly genuine early picture, only fetched £12,000, so that got a very wide range between 12,000 and 7 million. But I suppose there must be 20 pictures in this gallery, which must be worth £10 million each or more, so that's 200 million. There must be. I think that the safest thing is to say hundreds of millions of pounds, really.
He came from a barber's shop down a dark entry off Covent Garden near the Piazza. Just down the road was the Strand and the Leiterman and the river, which he spent a lot of time on, and down the river was London, the Pool of London, at London Bridge, with a forest of masts, all sailing ships, of course. And that's where he grew up, and of course, he was a Cockney. He had a Cockney accent. He thought like a Cockney and spoke like a Cockney. His father was 5'0". In fact, he was a talkative little barber who was always spinning up on his feet, on his toes, to talk to people because he was so small. And Turner was the same. And at 14, Turner was sent to the Royal Academy schools. He got in, he passed the test. At 21, he had his first oil painting. hung there. It was original. It was a sea piece, fishermen in their boats, but it was not at sun, not in daylight, but in moonlight. And at 24, he was elected, the youngest age you could be elected, associate member of the Royal Academy, ARA, and he had arrived. He was drawn by George Dance, who drew all the academicians, and he even drew, set up his own self-portrait and painted himself in oils. A very rare thing, because he was so self-conscious that he wouldn't allow, ever afterwards, anybody to do his portrait. He explained why to one of his friends. He said, people seeing my likeness will say, such a little fellow as this can never draw.
Conditions were right at the time, in the early 19th century, for an artist's gifts and temperament. The Royal Academy was established, and the British art had come of age, or the British school had come of age, and at the same time, it was a very open society for good and ill, that the individual was very much on his own, and Turner had these fantastic individual human resources. He'd have this amazing energy, this sort of organizing ability, and he flourished in this, in a sense, almost chaotic atmosphere. And he had the power to do that. And there is it is the range of his art which is so striking. I mean, his art is almost, one might say, as wide as society itself. And of course, as wide as the Europe that he knew. I mean, and what one sees the nature, one sees the sky, mountains, water, and then you see agriculture, industry, buildings, and all kinds of, indeed, war, peace, all kinds of, the whole range of human beings as well. And he allied all this, of course, with amazing technical skill, marvelous taste in terms of color and light effects and transitions of tone and all that kind of thing, but which doesn't go with a sort of, if you like, a kind of a Rococo chic, because it's something very individual. And this, too, I think, gives one this sense of the great genius. And it's worth perhaps saying that I think that Turner and one or two other artists of his generation were the first British landscapists to be recognized as men of genius.
Life was pretty miserable at Maiden Lane, to be quite honest, because of his mother. His mother was mad, or going mad. She had an ungovernable temper, people said, and it began like that, but it got worse, and obviously she was mentally disturbed. And by the time he was 25, he and his father had to commit her to a mental hospital called the Bethlehem Hospital, which popularly became known as Bedlam. But he was hardly ever at home because he began traveling from an early age, and his travels, Turner's travels, were heroic. I mean, by the end of his life, when he had gone from the tip of Scotland and Highlands of Scotland right down to the southern tip of Italy, people calculated he had done a good 100,000 miles in those days, and he had filled over 300 sketchbooks.
When Turner was 22 years old, he came on his first visit to the north of England. He traveled through Derbyshire and Yorkshire Dales, round Northumberland and the Tweed Valley, finally crossing over the Pennines into the Lake District, where we see this scene of Buttermere. It's called Buttermere Lake. Well, in actual fact, we've got really Buttermere Mere, in other words, aren't we? Two lakes. But this foreground lake is Crummock Water, and only a bit of Buttermere you can see is under the lit-up portion by the rainbow. But Turner was out more to paint his feelings about the Lake District rather than the pure topography. It wasn't a case of making a map of the scenes, you would say. He hated his picture to be mappy. So this picture really is more poetic, and his love of poetry is felt by the fact that he used for the caption in the Royal Academy catalogue, which they were allowed in that year, 1798, to quote a piece of Thomson's poetry. So this is a quotation from The Seasons of Thomson, out of spring. The grand ethereal bow is showing, rising there, unfolding every hue of colour. In other words, this is the main aspect of the picture. And it is foreshadowing Turner's great love of nature and the way that he could interpret nature as he got older. In other words, he was a painter, really, of stress and nature in a state of flux. as the gallery will show, with the great storms of Hannibal and the great avalanches, the fires at sea, the burning of the Houses of Parliament. He's an epic painter, and this is really showing you, as a young man, how wonderful his genius was going to develop.
The Royal Academy was really Turner's family. That's how he saw it. But the great days at the Royal Academy in those days were the varnishing days. They called them varnishing days, but really they were painting days. 3 or 4 days before the annual exhibition opened, everybody's picture was hung on the wall. They knew where it was going to be, and they were allowed to finish it. Well, Turner practically started it, as well as finishing it, on the wall. And he was famous for doing this. People would come just to watch him do it, this little figure standing on a bench or on a box in order to reach it.
Turner was a very canny man as far as money was concerned, as far as reputation was concerned, realizing the two were inextricable. And so he always trod a very formal line with the Academy. Presentation pictures of this kind, always with a classical base, always with a reference to the kind of grand old master everyone would accept. This particular example is pure Claude, for example. It's 200 years back in terms of composition and lighting and everything. Because what you needed to do at the Academy was to keep a kind of formal foot forward. Everybody saying, oh yes, here's a grand man in the classical tradition. What Turner did privately, because he ran his own gallery just off Harley Street, was to present rather less formal pictures, so that you had two sides of Turner running at the same time.
I was just riveted by this painting. To call a painting modern is not necessarily a relevant remark, but the fact is that both Turner and Constable, and we have, of course, two equally immensely great painters, were fantastically revolutionary. And it was 60 years before the French, the surfaces of Impressionist, French Impressionist painting, really took their cue from... It's the breaking up of surfaces. And people don't seem to realize that until Turner and Constable started painting like this, and this is reasonably early, I think it's 1807, but until that happened, nearly all painting that you can possibly think of from the Renaissance on had been a matter of creating the illusion of continuous, smooth, almost shiny surfaces, continuous surfaces. This breaking up into these facets, which are created by a brushstroke apiece. The brushstrokes here are so fresh, they could have been put on yesterday. I mean, here's this, whatever it is, this chap on the bank here. There are three touches with a very small brush, which has got yellow on the underside and ochre on the top, put on just like that. The side of that house is one brushstroke. This bridge has been painted with a series of tiny brushstrokes all going down like that. They're overlapping. It's a brilliant device because, in fact, you read it as a perfectly symmetrical architectural statement. It is a moment of extraordinary revolutionary inventiveness, and I mean, the idea that the English can't produce the greatest painting in the world, once we've had Constable and Turner, there's absolutely no reason for anybody to feel ashamed of being English again.
These pictures, I think perhaps partly because they have no frames, which was a great help, seem to me to be the final perfection, if one could put it like that, of Turner's art. He had spent a lifetime painting from nature, painting pictures in emulation of other artists. He painted like Titian, he painted like Claude, he even tried to paint like Poussin at one time. He eventually, I think, with these two extraordinary pictures of Venice, when he was a very old man, joined the ranks of the very greatest artists who've ever lived, because the remnants of all he'd learnt, these sort of traces of all he'd learnt, had finally liberated him, so that he who couldn't ever really draw the figure no longer needed to. He who had found the description of the precise details of nature, which he did very well as a young man, no longer necessary. He who had painted so many pictures of Venice, of which the room in which these pictures hang is full, finally was able to paint two extraordinary images which are not nostalgic. They are infinitely romantic because they are not trapped at any moment of time. They might just as well be the Venice that you're going to look at when you next go there as the Venice that Turner himself remembered. Paint, which he'd used for so many different, perhaps extraneous reasons ultimately, had become completely his ally as an artist, and so any mark that he made, any thickening of the paint, any transparency, any tiny little smudge or nudge to the painted surface became light, air, figures, and somehow became the world itself.
Well, I have the distinction of living down the same road as Turner. I live in Cheyne Walk in Chelsea, and it overlooks the river. And when I get up in the morning and I pull back my curtains, I see the same river that inspired Turner. And I can see why he was so interested in light and mists and colour, because every day the river is different. Some days it's silver, some days it's gold, and greys and greens. There's always a different thing there. And he loved painting water. And I've chosen this picture here called Sea Monster. I don't think this is the Thames, actually. But this is the nearest thing I can find, being a caricaturist, to my work, in a way. He has depicted here a monster which is emerging from the mists. And it's a strange picture for Turner, really. He's gone outside his usual brief here and used his imagination. I'm not quite sure where he got the idea of a sea monster, because it's something he must have delved into his own imagination for. And in general, he relied on the landscape or the world around him, which he created in his own form in his pictures. But this can only have come from his mind. Maybe he was just doing a seascape and suddenly this thing began to emerge, as monsters do, from the normal environment. Perhaps it was some figment of his imagination which took place in oil on the paper.
Turner took advantage of a permission which the Royal Academy allowed, and that was that quotations could be placed in the catalogue to go with the picture. And really, to make sense of this picture, the quotation should be with it. And it is from Milton's Paradise Lost. Turner's lines are, Turner's choice of lines are significant, and they are, "Ye mists and exhalations that now rise from hill or steaming lake, dusky or grey, till the sun paint your fleecy skirts with gold, in honour to the world's great author, rise." And you can see that the picture, in first glance, is about rising. You go right up the picture, you fall into the light, above the halfway mark, into a valley, and then find yourself suddenly falling even higher into another valley above. And you can see all the fleecy gold being sort of a motif. But then you become aware that there's images of fall in a very literal sense. A waterfall is placed in the foreground of the picture. Turner's added to that a kind of movement downwards with a horse and wagon which has nobody in control of it, but just the sense that you're going down into the dark. Like all romantics, they're not really interested in heaven and hell, they're interested in the opposition between dark and light. But the clue to the whole picture is that when you go close to the flock of sheep, which is like the Middle Earth, where all of us live, where the matter-of-fact life is going on, and you find that the shepherds are in fact not two men, but a man and a woman. And then you suddenly realise that Turner has taken the great leap of making it just literally paradise. And that's what gives it its excitement for me.
Certainly, during the formative years of the company, Turner's work played quite a substantial part in the development. For example, a few years ago, the company's catalogue had this painting of the Jane Pier Brighton featured on its cover. We found in the past that Turner's work, although it sold in many thousands when reproduced in print form, and in particular a subject called The Fighting Temeraire sold in very large quantities, these sales really were in England. We had the Battle of Trafalgar, this painting, the Jane Pier Brighton, and the Fighting Temeraire. In order of sales preference, I think the most popular undoubtedly was the Fighting Temeraire. I think the second popular was Jane Pier Brighton, and third, the Battle of Trafalgar.
This really is it's a cracking good picture, this. What fascinates me as a student and as a painter is how he's held it all together as a unity. How he's held the whole composition together as a sort of single entity.
I think he's built it out of areas of light and dark, so using those as building blocks. I think your eye goes in from here, between the contrast between the light and dark here, through to the subject, which is a sort of cart crossing the stream. But then you come out again here, and up to this bit of bank here, and through out again here, all the time working light against dark, dark against light. I was quite shocked when I came in here and saw this in the original for the first time, because in the reproduction it's in reverse, it's all the other way around. So I that really took me aback a bit, I couldn't believe it. It's in one of the major volumes on Turner too.
The thing that must be remembered is Turner basically originally was a watercolour painter, and he was felt happiest in producing a translucency, a translucent effect, and he was always looking for this in his oil paintings. And this often resulted in him using many layers which didn't dry at the same rate, and therefore, produced cracks and problems of the paint not binding together. I have here a photograph which was taken in 1956 when it was at the National Gallery, and this is basically the same state it was in up to about a year ago. And you can see that it has very definite crackles along the skyline and going into the clouds and coming down into the sea. And it was in these areas that one gradually sort of reduced these striations, really. The other thing to note in this picture is the frame, which is original to the painting, which was shown in the Royal Academy. And we have now taken a slightly more historic viewpoint of the frame, and this has been cleaned and not re-gilded, but left, as in the state it is, but as cleaned to become a harmonious whole with the painting.
I've chosen a painting by Turner, which is known as The Snowstorm. It's a picture which was lampooned, and this lampooning upset Turner enormously in his own lifetime. It was described as being nothing but a load of soapsuds and whitewash. He was in touch with the cosmic forces, almost like a sage, let's say, and was, for example, I think he would turn up at private functions at the Royal Academy and so forth in working trousers covered in paint, and everyone just thought he was an oddball. But you can understand that there is a place for such people whose minds are so far somewhere else, they just don't have the time of day for normal ritual. And I think this does express, it is the picture where, in which he was, he captured the scene while he was lashed to the mast for 4 hours. And, that's an incredible stance for any human being to take, to live through a storm, and he didn't expect to survive, actually, and to come out of it and to make some attempt at depicting these forces at play. It moves, it precedes Tashism and action painting and all these things, and you can see the painting swirls with all kinds of movements. It's almost cubist, the way that there are apparent lines dividing the picture up. It's a picture in which there is just nothing but emotion and energy. It's a tremendous thing.
Turner became reclusive, and he hid himself away. I mean, why was it that he got no royal commissions? Why was it he was never knighted? Practically every artist of note in the Academy was knighted, but not Turner, the greatest. Because Queen Victoria was certain he was mad. She told, George V told Kenneth Clarke, when he was walking around the National Gallery, he said, of course, trouble Turner, he's mad. I mean, my grandmother said so.
I've chosen this painting because it seems to have an enormous paradox in it, which I'm very partial to. It's quite sinister, and there's a kind of brooding, dark force developing in it, and frightened animals, and certainly a feeling that something awful is about to happen. But at the same time, the light is coming through and is there in the background. And I think, I mean, a lot of Turner's paintings have that kind of paradox in them, but this one especially. I think that the repetition of this kind of theme says something about him, because it appears in quite a few of the paintings. A very transcendent light that is accompanied by very dark forces at work. Sometimes they're black, as with this painting. Sometimes you find these kind of bloody sunsets appearing in it. It certainly would suggest to me that he lived very close to that sense of paradox in life, that there's some kind of yearning or hope or faith in a divine intelligence, whether one sees it as God or one sees it as within human beings. But also, he seems to have been very aware of how easy it is for destruction to be unleashed. And what that says about his personality, I'm not sure. He certainly seems to have perched right in the middle of a very difficult ambivalence that many people find intolerable.
I think it's very interesting in the context of romantic landscape how much Turner can express in a simple scene of what for him were everyday things, a ship, small sailing ships, a setting sun, a pier, some sand, some waves. And it has a most marvellous mood of cold dawn, with the sun as really the only touch of colour in the whole picture. Very cleverly expressed by the way he's just left a band across it to show this ship shining out through clouds. It's an unfinished picture. He never exhibited this in the Royal Academy. Later on, he did a picture rather like it called Fort Vimeo, which showed a battleship being fired on off the French coast. But in this case, because it's in the same format as a whole group of pictures painted at Petworth, one likes to think of it as an English coastal scene. In fact, if you turn it into a French coastal scene, it turns into a sunset rather than a sunrise, which would destroy a lot of my feeling for the painting.
Yes, this is a very interesting painting because it's so unusual in that most of his paintings are either landscapes or seascapes. This is an interior painting. It's actually a painting, Music Party, East Cars Castle, painted in 1835. And it's a society painting of the type of places that he used to visit. It's got a musical and artistic connection. It's very interesting also because he was noted for his interest in light, and there is the symbolism here of lightness and darkness. And I think, though, the real interest for us is the musical connection. We're sponsoring the first in a series of music concerts in the Clough Gallery, music in the period of Turner. And, of course, rather like his paintings, it's a very rich period for composers.
If you look at this drawing room here, what's remarkable about it is there's so little furniture in it. The 18th century, they didn't like to clutter things up. By the end of the century, that whole room would have been filled with bric-a-brac. But there you see the very classical lines of a drawing room. You see the French influence. And then underneath here is the library with the piano. The detail there is so beautiful, and it gives you such a feeling of being in a library. So we've had plenty of interiors of this period and of other periods, but what is so rare is to have an interior done by somebody who also happened to be a genius, and this is what makes these so special. And over here, which is an interesting little picture of an artist at work at Petworth. Lord Egremont filled the house with children, mainly his own, and artists. And here we see someone at work on a portrait, and here with the finished product, or a finished product. And here again you see that wonderful eye for colour, for shape, and you get the feeling of the interior of a great house at the height, really, of a gracious living, the end of the 18th century, although in fact painted just at the first part of the 19th.
I chose this painting when I was looking for ideas for my current collection. Why I chose it I particularly like the shapes of the buildings, the details of the buildings, the black and white of these strong shapes of the gondolas, the colour in the sky against the salmon pink. When I first saw this painting, I thought Turner was in his early 20s because it looked so young, but in fact he was about 60 when he painted it. After seeing this painting, I just had to go to see to Venice for myself. But coming back and seeing this painting again, Turner's view of Venice is much better than going there to see it for yourself, because he's actually moved back this building so you can see the excitement that's going on in the canal. The strong shapes, like I use the black and white as colours, and I use the shapes of the gondolas into prints, and just generally the feeling, a Venetian feeling.
It's a picture really with about 47 years painting experience in it. It's the kind of painting which his critics didn't like at all. Somebody said Turner's paintings were of nothing and very like. Constable talked about Turner using tinted steam. I mean, I think it's a marvellous picture. It's so modern, it's so wonderfully painted. It's all this wonderful colour. It is nothing in a sense, but my God, colour, light, it's everything which a lot of modern art is about. I mean, I wonder if Turner were alive now for the opening of this place. He was going around the Queen and the Duke of Edinburgh through the modern collection. I wonder what he'd have to say about it all. This picture takes me right through to Monet, to the late Monets. Monet made a marvellous, several marvellous paintings of the Thames, Westminster, with the fog and the mist, straight out of Turner. And when Monet died, about 1926, Mark Rothko was born in America. At least, I mean, he started painting in America in 1926. And this even takes us through into Rothko. I mean, that picture, in a sense, would not look out of date or out of place if it had been done by a young artist today and was just being exhibited as a new work.
As relatives of Turner, we are extremely fond of the sea. We are seafaring folk. And this has one of these pictures, therefore, well, all his seascapes are particularly, we admire enormously. But our grandfather sailed the Horn, and Turner, we think, came to love the sea through going down to Ilfracombe when he was a boy and was probably studying those breakers down there. And so Russ Turner's father and grandfather, they also were great seafarers too.
That's right. Well, of course, his grandpa really was the great sea captain going around the Cape of Good Hope. And, of course, we've chosen this picture because it really does show Turner at his best with seascapes.
And
it's so dramatic. We've got the drama there of the ship and the men there, all in great detail, yet at the same time he throws at you the storm. You've got the dark sky and the fierce sea enveloping all these poor men who they're endeavouring to save. Of course, my cousin and I are both very proud to be able to claim to be relatives of the late J.M.W. Turner. And I would just like to conclude with some of the last words that he said, which I think are rather appropriate. They said that upon his death, it is through these eyes, closed forever, at the bottom of the tomb, that generations as yet unborn will see nature.
Turner's life. Ruskin, very young, but earlier influential as an aesthete and a man who could promote a reputation, who really made late Turner intelligible to a general audience at all.
He had some properties in Wapping, which he had inherited, and he knocked two or three cottages together and made them into a pub. The fact that Turner had this property at Wapping and used to spend weekends there actually turned out to be the biggest shock of Ruskin's life, because when he was going through the boxes and boxes of drawings, he had this unpleasant surprise. One day, he said, I came across a portfolio filled with painting after painting of the most shameful sort. My hero used to go down to Wapping on a Friday and live there till Monday with the sailors' women, painting them in every posture of abandonment. And eventually, he came to the conclusion, with the agreement of the director of the National Gallery, that they should all be burned. Now, Ruskin was the worst man you could have asked to have made this discovery. He had plenty of sexual hang-ups himself. His own marriage was never consummated, and he was appalled.
Jim Sterling is probably, possibly, Britain's most well-known architect, but strangely enough, he's more known abroad, where he's built such galleries as the Stuttgart Gallery, which has, I think, more visitors than any other gallery in Germany, for instance, in the States, where he has built a building in Harvard for Museum Again, the Fog, and numerous other buildings. So he's really quite well known outside this country, both in the general field of architecture and for building museums. So he was a very logical person to select, I think, for the Tate.
The galleries had to be an extension of the existing Tate, but at the same time they had to be an independent building. So you have the situation here where we have the garden entrance to the new building, but also the public coming from the existing Tate can walk through at the same level. So the building is both an extension and a new building. There are spaces in the building which are absolutely deferential to the paintings, the galleries. There the background is very calm, very subdued. There's no colour. It's all sort of a suppressed background. There are other spaces in the building where there's no art. The entrance hall, the lecture theatre, the reading room. And in those spaces, they're more architectural. There's colour, there's changes of scale, there's architectural distractions. And I think that's quite permissible, and it does give the building a sort of identity.
The trustees are extremely happy with the building, and so, I believe, is the Clough Foundation, who paid for this, for the building. Of course, it's only a quarter of the overall plan. We have three further buildings at the back of this. There's a wonderful sculpture courtyard in the front. There's a great courtyard to be completed here. This is all part of a complex, because so many people come nowadays to visit museums. More and more, millions and millions of people come. As far as sort of its success, I think there is criticism. There's always criticism. There's tremendous criticism of Turner. People said, what is the paintings about? What is all this color and movement across the canvas? Why aren't there little people, little trees, little boats, and so on? And the answer now can be seen is that he was, in a sense, like all great masters, ahead of his time. If we didn't actually accept advance, we should all still be living in caves. If we just copied the past, it'd be still caves.
This study room here in the Clough Gallery is a new facility where the public at large are welcome to come and look at all the works on paper in the Turner Bequest, which is a very much larger concern, of course, than just the 300 oil paintings in the display outside. So we hope that it will provide pleasant, intimate surroundings in which people can look at these remarkable works, sketchbooks, drawings, magnificent finished watercolours, the whole range of his output. In a lot of respects, this magnificent view of Smugglers off Folkestone is a watercolour that appeals to me particularly because it seems to sum up in a lot of ways Turner's greatest loves and interests. He was fascinated by all the activities of the seacoast, just as his paintings reflect every aspect of human life and human experience. So his watercolours very often dredge deep into the significance of particular places. They're not just views of towns or villages. They are discussions of the way of life that characterizes those places. This particular drawing is unusual in that it shows us how he set about an academic duty of his, which was giving a series of lectures on perspective to the students at the Royal Academy. He took those duties very seriously, and he worked very hard studying all the standard texts and treatises on the subject of perspective. And because, of course, in those days there were no coloured slides or anything like that, he made the most wonderful drawings, sometimes very large, watercolours and diagrams illustrating the points that he wanted to make. But here we can see that he's he's drawing his students' attention to various aspects of the geometry of the perspective that the subject deals with. This is ostensibly a view on the air with Kirkstall Abbey, a traditional picturesque subject. But in fact, Kirkstall Abbey is a long way in the background, and what we actually see is a lock on a canal rather than the river itself, which is some way away. So it's an example of Turner's idiosyncratic way of choosing the subjects that suited him rather than the ones that he thought his public would expect. And we can also see from this example how marvelously his technique was up to the reduced scale, to cramming a lot of information, a lot of atmosphere, a lot of human activity into this very small space. This is one of the stunning drawings that Turner made in connection with his series of views on the great rivers of Europe, which was another project of the 1820s. And here you can see it's a much freer drawing because the design was never brought to the stage at which it would have to be engraved. This is a mere study, an idea, a thought that flits through his mind. It's dashed down in this marvelous sweep of crimson and yellow, an astonishing achievement. It seems to sum up Turner's vision. It's easy to believe that he might have done a drawing like this actually in situ. I can't imagine anybody taking a pot of paints into a crowded theatre, but that's the feeling, the intimacy, the sense of the impact of the theatrical moment. And I feel that in a way sums up a great deal of Turner's art. It's highly theatrical. It's a marvelous, sudden, dramatic image which he wants us all to participate in.
I think the real legacy of Turner is his actual paintings to begin with. I think they're so good, they're so varied, they're so rich, but basically they are so good that one doesn't need to look any further. He has, of course, influenced other artists, but perhaps less than some people say. He's always called the precursor of the Impressionists, but his intentions were totally different. I think he encouraged Impressionists, particularly those that came over in 1870 at the time of the Franco-Prussian War, because they suddenly realized that you didn't have to be very meticulous, you didn't have to paint everything in great detail. And here was an artist who was revered in England, who had got away with painting in a very impressionistic, to use the word in a very impressionistic way. Other 20th century artists have been influenced by him. But he doesn't have an influence, you can't trace a line of great artists anywhere in the way that, say, you can trace a line of artists influenced by William Blake and Samuel Palmer. There are some rather minor artists that you can actually say, well, he's been looking too hard at Turner. But as I think really his achievement is what he actually painted. That's what this gallery is all about.
Do you think that this collection here of 300 oil paintings, 20,000 watercolours, engravings and so on, is decently, properly, adequately representative of Turner?
No. And that really does have to be the answer. Here, within the confines of this gallery, the answer is no.
What's missing then?
What is missing are the really stunning pictures. And there are stunning pictures scattered all over the world. I mean, if you really want to do a service to Turner, you pull together the best. You do not put on view permanently the worst. Much of this is material that was, as it were, studio sweepings. There are pictures which were left unfinished because he realized at an early stage that they were unfinishable, not because they were so beautiful in that unfinished state, but because he couldn't resolve the problems that he'd set himself.
Well, it's odd you should say that, because I found that one of the attractions of the collection, particularly in the reserve rooms upstairs, which take their colour, the wall colour, from the artist's own studio, and feel as if you're going into an artist's studio, and once one gets the catalogue so you can find out exactly what's going on, the idea of half-finished works, works begun and abandoned, and that's works in process, works leading to other works, and then the finished work around, I find that rather attractive than anything else.
It's an argument I'm perfectly prepared to accept, but I think nevertheless that without the very best pictures here, and the very best pictures are absent, you are dealing with a level of achievement which is below the real Turner.
We've had the Fauve paintings of Matisse in 1905, 1907. Here is a Fauve sky. Here is a tree of a slightly later Matisse period. Here is a depositing with a knife of pigment, some white with some blue smeared in it, and some dark ultramarine, slightly indigo, left there, absolutely functional in its pictorial sense. But I mean, if you simply look at this area alone, it could be almost any important non-figurative painting of the last part of the present century. The extraordinary fluidity and freshness, the way in which the making of the painting is itself left totally visible, that itself is something which we're attuned to this now. But in fact, Turner was perfectly content with this. I don't care if it was, nobody's going to tell me that the so-called sketches are in any way not intended. Everything here gave him total satisfaction, and the fact that it absolutely chimes with our own thoughts and feelings about painting is simply something that one has to respond to. I see no way round this. It's extraordinarily in tune with one's contemporary feelings about the way paintings are made and the state in which they are reach completion. And as such, I mean, this is a Fauve painting almost exactly 100 years before its time. It is these extraordinary equations which really should be considered consciously now.
He's seen so often, quoted so often, as the precursor of the Impressionists. And in fact, when you look even at the freest of Turner's, Impressionism isn't the next step at all. It seems to me that Turner was one of those individual geniuses like Botticelli who hit upon a line of development that nobody else could follow. And he was away and off on his own. And at the end of his life, the general sort of critical acclaim was, well, here's a great painter, but we find this kind of greatness very elusive, very difficult to understand, very difficult to pin down. And so mid-19th century painting in England was rather plodding after that. There is no connection whatever with French painting. Nobody took it on. The real followers for Turner are people like the members of New English Art Club around about 1900, who took on from the Thames sketches done in 1807. You have a whole century before anything that you could really say was Turner's influence begins to happen.
There are obviously a lot of ways in which you can retrospectively see aspects of his work that anticipate Impressionism, Expressionism, abstraction, even cubism, possibly, all sorts of things. But I would say that however interesting it is to see him in those terms, it's actually completely to misinterpret what he was about. He was much more concerned with developing the tradition of the old masters that he really admired and grafting himself onto the existing threads of British art, of European art.
So how would you describe his reputation?
His reputation has always been very high. He's always been admired as an innovator, a very original genius, sometimes to the point of being eccentric or even mad. But I think that he needs to be seen more as the culmination of the great classic tradition of European landscape painting rather than as the beginning of something new.
He was famous, he was rich, but he wasn't understood. He was totally misunderstood. And so he drew into himself, he hoarded his paintings, he tried to buy them back, and all with the object of keeping them together, his children. And one day, he knew it would take a long time, one day, if they were all kept together and then given to the nation and shown in a special gallery, such as this one, he felt the day would come when they were understood.